Hi, it's Warren Huart here. Hope you're doing marvelously well. We are back here at Vintage King Los Angeles with Alex. How are you?
Hi. Great to see you, Warren. Thanks for coming down.
I'm going to ask you, because I didn't actually ask you all the time we've been talking before, how do I pronounce your last name properly?
Owana.
Owana.
You know, there's that Disney movie, Moana, that's just come out. Everyone now will know how to pronounce my last name. Just take the Owana. M off of Moana. You've got Owana.
Yeah. I don't know why. I looked at it and I was like, I don't know how to pronounce that. And I forgot to ask.
It's better to ask. You know what I
it
mean?
It is.
Yeah, thank you.
Especially if it was on camera and I was like, bleh. Which is quite likely.
You haven't talked about how tall I am yet.
Yes, I know. You're taller than me. I'm only 6 foot and a bit, and you are 6'4".
Somewhere over there, yeah.
I've got to stand up straight now, or else I'm going to feel very, very short.
Depends on the shoes.
Yes. Well, you've got a bit of a heel, but I should have worn the 2-inch Cubans, and then I could have been like, hey. Anyway, so we're back here. What I personally have loved about VK for years, I've known Mike now, the owner, for a long, long time. I've recommended VK in a million times for a million different artists, and everybody I know, you know, shops here. And the reason why we shop here is because of guys like you, which are just guys like us. Yeah. You know, you've been producing and engineering now for years. You talked about starting in the late 80s.
Yeah.
When you were two.
I'm kind of losing count of the decades, but yeah.
Right.
That's how I got into it. That's why I'm doing it.
So you're still doing it. Like, yeah. I still produce and engineer and make music, and I run the YouTube channel on the side doing it. You're doing this and you're still producing and engineering.
Yeah, mixing 3 tracks from different artists as we speak.
As you speak?
Yeah.
Right. I'm
right over
impressed.
There.
Right over there.
Another workstation.
No, but it's good. And that's why I came here to film, because I want to have real world experiences. So what are we going to do? We are going to do microphones. Now, it's not a science. This is not going to be a science. I think even if we had a singer on every single one emulating it, still not a science. I was just thinking about this earlier when we were talking about the best way to present it. And I thought to myself, I've worked with, I don't know, thousands of singers over my life. And the first vocal take and the fifth vocal take is a completely different tone, because you come in and you have all that warmth. And as you sing, you lose it, which is sometimes fine. Or there's some people that have to warm up. So it seems to me there's no real science way of doing this, unless you could figure out if you got 10 capsules at the same point, which would be impossible, and then did one vocal take. So we're just going to do real world, couple of dudes putting on headphones, listening to some mics. So it's not science. It's just the Warren produced like a pro method of doing this. But we are going to record it. We're going to talk about it. But I also think the other thing that that you guys have always been really helpful at, and this is, I think, is a good point, is for us to maybe talk about who buys this mic. Mm-hmm. Like, what kind of person buys it? Because when I think about it, especially things like speakers, you know, when we're talking like monitors and stuff, you've got small speakers that maybe for a guy with a huge studio, maybe they're references because they want to hear like what it would sound like on a boombox or whatever. But then there's also like, you know, room size to take into account. So there's a lot of other things. So that's good information, because when I go online and I want to know something, these are the kind of questions. It's not always about the price. It's not always even necessarily about user reviews. I want to know, what exactly is this made for? Yeah. Why? So let's talk about the mics, how they sound, but let's also talk about what your customers like. Because mm-hmm. that will tell me a lot, because if you say, oh, my home guys really like this mic.
Right.
There's going to be a reason, because they're going to keep coming back. And I think that's another viewpoint that maybe isn't represented as much.
Well, let's talk about one of the main reasons why we're doing this. We're trying to bring something that's a localized physical thing that exists in Los Angeles. And it's an incredible resource that Vintage King built here. I mean, if I'd had access to this in my 20s, when I came up as a recording engineer, and the ability to compare 24 of the world's best microphones in one place at one time, I would have made more informed decisions.
Right.
Now, not everyone can get to Los Angeles, even though we actually have people flying from all over the world to come visit the showroom version of what they see online.
Right.
So, you know, I'm excited that our goal is to try to take a piece of what we can know by experiencing the microphones firsthand and somehow make that useful to people outside of this room.
Yep.
So, yeah, whatever we talk about, I want to keep that as the context.
Absolutely,
and as the goal. One of the first things I talk about with people when they come in to demo a microphone, the folks who are fortunate enough to come in, is that they're also personal. And it's great to be able to take a particular voice and find the microphone that's best suited for them.
Right.
But of course, then we have to acknowledge, okay, but what if that person, you know, sometimes does pop? What if they're a producer and they produce a whole range of stuff?
Cool. That's exactly what I want to know.
Yep.
I want to know because I know the only way that this, when I do this, works for me is like, it's just to be, does it work for me? Do I watch these videos and do I actually learn something? And what I'd want to know, frankly, is who buys this mic? Why do they buy it?
Right. Good.
Because that's really going to help me. Like if you said to me this $1,000 blah, blah, blah clone or whatever it might be, doesn't matter what it is bought a lot by pop guys. That's going to help me out a lot.
Good. And let's also though, make the distinction about bandwagon mentality.
Sure.
Because some of it's like, oh, I heard that, you know, Dr. Luke uses this mic, so therefore I have to use this mic.
Sure.
We should dispel some of those myths and realize that the microphones in this room, by and large, you can make a great recording with.
You know, another thing, you're touching on something that's exciting is community as well. Because this is opinions. These aren't facts. Yeah. And this is really, really important because what I'd like is for us to be able to talk about these and also like people to have their opinions on using the mics as well. Because the thing that excites me about what I do is the fact that there's a nice sense of community around it.
Yeah.
You know, most of the comments are not trolling. Most of the comments are people going, hey, I like what you did there, but I use this. And it's very positive. And I make loads of mistakes in my videos. Tons.
As in we do in life.
Yeah, you know? In life. And when somebody tells me I've done something wrong, I'm like, oh, you're right. I screwed that up. I did that wrong. I put it in the wrong order. I distorted it. Whatever. It's like, that's what happens.
That's art, man. You have to put yourself out there realizing I'm going to make mistakes. There are going to be people who don't like what I do.
Yeah.
You just got to keep going.
All right. Well, let's get started because we could do this for hours.
Okay. And one more thing, if I may, about, you know, I talked about the avoiding the bandwagon mentality.
Sure.
But the other thing is that I also acknowledge, and you have an art background, your family, and we're all artists in our way, whether we're a recording engineer, you know, painting with sound, sculpting sound, or a musician or a combination. Really what I love about all the different gear that's made, and especially it comes down to microphones. Microphones are one of the most most significant tone makers in your whole recording chain. They can be. And I love the fact...
Well, the first point of entry.
Yeah, yeah. Mm-hmm. If we're starting with anything recorded, anything acoustically recorded, exactly. Yeah. And these, I love the fact that we can go in and make these really strong choices about what paints are on the palette. Sure. And we should 100% go with inspiration.
Okay, well, that being said, let's start before we go to the microphones.
Yeah.
All of these mics, with, of course, the exception of the Slate, the VMS, which has its own mic pre.
Yep.
All of these mics are all going through the same mic pre. So I actually don't know the Antelope. I haven't used the X. So can you tell us about the Antelope before we get started?
What I know about it, these are all Class A mic pre's, and you know, we throw around terms. We're going to be doing that a lot, and it's as hard to dance about architecture as it is to, you know, put words to audio.
Yeah.
But I find them the number one thing is that it's a fair fight. We're hearing
all, from
all
the same
of them
pre.
Equal.
Yeah.
So all these microphones will be interpreted equally because it's all the same mic pre, but I think they're great sounding. They're open, they're natural sounding. I feel like they're not adding anything and they're not taking anything away. So they're not a heavy like transformer based Neve kind of vibe.
So they're relatively neutral.
Yeah,
they're neutral. Not going to color it that much.
That's the word. Yeah. That's the word. Thank you.
Yeah, we were joking about this earlier about all those words that we're so tired of, like transparent and warm and all this kind of stuff. These are relatively neutral, so they're not going to color the sound too
and
much.
Great, though. I think these really show us what the microphones are actually putting
out. Okay, great.
Out. So a good thing to be going through.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, I like stuff that colors as well, but I get your point. It's like if something had like a huge low-mid boost, it might take a mic that doesn't have low mids and give it an unfair advantage.
And here's a trippy thing. Some of these mics actually take better to a variety of mic pre's or processing after them. And some sound like they're already finished, you know, coming out and might not like to play with a transformer.
I felt that way about the Aston, just going off on a tangent for a second, because the Aston's a lot cheaper mic. I know it's a very successful mic, but I felt like the high end was so hyped on that.
Right.
I mean, it's like this.
Yeah.
That I think a lot of the reason, and this is fine, but a lot of the reason why I think people like it is because it already sounds like it's been EQ'd.
Mm-hmm.
There's not the low lows, although there's a weird low rumble down there, but there's not the low mids that you would get from other mics in that price range, but there's a super high hypedness that just makes it cut in your track.
And when you start clean, then you can do a lot with it afterwards. Sure. If you have the luxury of having, say, a tube mic pre to choose from and a transformer-based one and a clean and neutral one.
Yeah, don't get me wrong. I think the Aston was a wonderful mic, but I think a lot of, I think it is a great mic, but I think a lot of people probably love it because it immediately sounds good because of the hype top end. Which, hey, that's also, it's, you know, I say this all the time, so it's horses for courses, you know. If you do have choice, then you can have two or three different microphones and you can go with whatever's best for the situation. Mm. So here we are. We're in the, what do you call this? The mic room?
The mic booth.
Sure, mic booth.
Yeah.
Now, you've already done a Vintage King video that you did on 47s.
That's true.
Which I highly recommend.
Thank you.
But let's at least go through some 47s first. Mm-hmm. You have a lot of varieties here. And look, there's a couple of things. So what we're going to do is we're going to put on some headphones, and this is all going to be just personal opinions. We are recording the audio, though, so us talking into it, you're going to be able to hear it, you're going to be able to download it, all that kind of fun stuff. Neither of us are great singers, so it's not going to be about singing. It's just going to be like, how does it sound? But more importantly, I want to know, like we talked about earlier, your opinion on who's buying it, why they're buying it, and it will really kind of help us identify the product. So we have a pair of good old-fashioned 7506s.
As you requested.
Yeah, and look, these guys have some really expensive headphones. They have some Focals, they have some beautiful stuff, and we were thinking about that, and that would have been very accurate, but it's not very real world.
Yeah.
Because as much as I love $1,000 headphones, most people that watch this have got $1,000 worth of gear and are making records, and that's what we're trying to help out. We're trying to like point towards great value for money products, you know, or identify, you know, boutique, incredible, entry level, whatever, that's helped people. And I think I'd rather be listening on a pair of headphones like this that I know.
Yeah.
So,
and I do hope people will actually put on headphones for this.
Yeah,
though, right?
Definitely. Yeah, definitely. Yeah. And the fact you'll be able to download us waffling on as well. So you'll get higher quality stuff.
May I have the red ones, so to speak? Would you rather red or black?
No, I'll go with the Sony, so I know them.
I like the colors.
So the way they've got it set up here is they've got this, which is a really good idea.
Oh my God, you sound amazing.
Oh, there's reverb on it.
Only for our listening pleasure. As an artist, you know, you'd set up a cue mix with a little reverb on it.
Oh, what a good idea.
But we're capturing dry. So that's one of the things I like to do when folks come in to do a mic demo.
Interesting. 1-2-2-2. 1-2-2-2. Oh, I love this idea. Yeah. Just indulge me for 1 second.
Yeah.
1-2-2-2. 1-2-2-2. 1-2-2-2. Wow, just a quick left to right. There's some marked differences and lots of similarities. Mm-hmm. All right, so let's start over here because that's where you're standing.
Okay,
so what is that? This is one that the Flea that I hear a lot about.
Mm-hmm.
It's very popular, isn't it?
Flea 47 with the EF-12. It's standard issue, 3-4. About $4,000.
Right.
Yeah.
So it's like, take this with a pinch of salt the way I'm going to say it. It's a mid-price clone.
Yeah. Yeah.
Look, obviously, $3,000 to $4,000 is not a cheap microphone. Mm-hmm. But for the 47 clones.
Considering you can go up to $9,000. Yeah. Mid-price. Yeah. Yep.
And the originals are in the 15-ish for a good quality.
Absolutely. Yeah. Depending on condition.
Right. Yeah. Yeah. So this is like a mid-price. But very popular. I know a lot of people have these. So what can you tell us about it?
Well, the Flea, it's interesting if you know, just from appearance, you can see the Flea and the Two Wonders and the Telefunkens all look almost exactly the same.
Right.
It's possible that they even source some of their parts from the same place, or at least they're working from the same general set of blueprints. Yeah. And this Telefunken really seeks to be the most authentic to the original. You know, they Telefunken USA licensed the brand and the rights to everything, and they're trying to reproduce it as exactly as possible. And you could argue that if you were to have bought a U47 new off the shelf, so to speak, in the 1950s or 60s, that it might have sounded exactly like this.
Sure.
Yeah. But all these feature hand-built elements, hand-built capsules, just coming from different parts of the world. This is from Europe, these are from Texas, and this is from the East Coast of the U.S.
Oh, the Telefunken is made in the U.S.?
Yeah, and I think that any of these companies we could talk about, where do these parts come from? Mm-hmm. I'm sure that these are companies that source parts globally. But again, I don't like to get into these niggly little things about, you know, hey, where does that capsule come from?
And sure.
It's more about really what do the manufacturers do with it?
I have a dumb question because I was asked this. I like to, it's dumb for me, but I do you have a CMZ 563? You do have one over there?
Yeah, we do.
Okay, come in a second.
Mic. Now,
the reason why I want to bring this up is because Gefaul, and again, I don't want to get into the dogma, but it's just an interesting talking point. I don't like the dogma thing. I know nobody really does at Huart, but that is an M7 capsule. And that is the original capsule that used to be in these. Because mm-hmm. Gefaul still manufactures the original capsules.
That's right, yeah.
So is this a talking point? I'm not going to get into the whole dogma part because I know everybody's about M7 versus K47 or, you know, all of that stuff. But yeah.
They're still making it in the old way.
Yeah, still make it in the original way that these microphones first used, which is it PVC? Is that right?
Yeah, the PVC is the one that breaks up now. And now they're usually made of mylar. But some we do have some M7 capsules still being made of PVC. In fact, Gefaul makes one of each.
One of each, okay.
Yeah. And the PVC will break down eventually.
Right.
But, you know, now that we know that its lifespan is limited by what it's exposed to, heat, humidity in the studio, people know how to take better care of them.
But I'm sorry to, it's my fault to take us off onto that tangent. I don't want to do too much of that because there's so many websites and places and you can go and read, what's his name, Klaus Heinz and all this stuff. You can find the experts on this. In fact, actually, Neumann's own website is really useful for that stuff. I was on it the other day because at least they can talk authoritatively about it because they made the things in the first place. And there's a lot of good information out there if you want to find it. But let's actually just talk about the real world of a guy or girl coming in here to buy a mic.
How do they sound?
How do they sound? Yeah. So this is a $3,000 or $4,000mid-price clone. 1, 2, 2. I mean, it's clear, very, very clear. Now, we're not using pop screens. We could do, but hey, we're moving quickly. So 1, 2, 2, 2, 2. I mean, it sounds very beautiful. I have these headphones as well. Don't use them that often, but I know them well. 1, 2, 2, 2. It's got really good mid-range for a 47. 1, 2, 2, 2. Immediate feels like there's a low bump on this. Would you say that's right?
I love the richness and the lows of the wonders. Yeah, I definitely hear that.
Yeah.
And you know, here's the thing, Warren. I mean, some people will come in with an agenda like what's most authentic to an original 47? And you can judge based on that. But I like to just judge based on, you know, well, and that's fine. I think everybody's, you know, motivations are fine.
And the singer, like, because I'm not a great singer, as anybody knows who watches me. But and this is conjecture, but if I had a, you know, a falsetto-ish kind of voice, I might love this because I'm like, oh, this brings some warmth to my low.
So yeah.
Bring some lows to my thing.
Exactly.
Where this, my guy is immediately between these two. If these were my only two choices, that might be my rock and roll mic because of the mid-range.
Right.
Because that cuts through in heavy guitars and stuff, you know?
And it's different than just EQ, which is a big point about what these microphones bring to the situation because of the transformers that they go through on some of the mics and the tube circuits. It's different than just adding a bump, you know, at 150.
What's the ish price? This is 3 or 4. What's that?
There's two different wonders. The wonders look almost identical from the outside.
Yep.
You can tell the difference between the G, which is the more affordable version. It's about in the $3,500 range.
Yep.
And the standard CM7. They're both called CM7s. This is called a G. The standard CM7, their flagship, has the pattern selector on the microphone itself, like the original Telefunken or Neumann did.
Right.
They sound so close to one another, and they're...
What's the price range of this one?
That's in a little over 6.
Okay, so it's... All right.
Yeah.
Now I'm intrigued, because you said...
Mm-hmm.
1, 2, 2, 2, 1. 1, 2, 2, 2, 1. 1, 2, 2, 2, 1. 1, 2, 2, 2. I mean, they're so similar.
Very similar. And this one almost sounds like it has more richness in the bottom.
Yeah.
But I mean, this is one I steer people towards often because it has
Is it fixed in cardioid?
Yeah, I believe it is.
I mean, I don't want to not sell wonders for them, but I mean, 90% of my life, if not more, my 47 is in cardioid.
Actually, you know what? This is the pattern selector box on it. So no, I believe it's not limited to cardioid.
And it's $3,500.
And yeah, exactly. And one thing to know is there are so many microphones in this booth, and I would love to have every element of spec captured about each microphone. But even I'm constantly educating myself because. Yeah.
People, and my voice is so different to yours. Why don't you do me a favor and go between those two? I want to hear what it sounds like on your voice.
Warren Huart. Warren Huart. Warren Huart. Warren Huart.
I got my eyes closed. I actually like the second one you did. Which was the second one?
Had a bit more clarity.
Yeah, a bit more clarity. Mm-hmm. That was the second one?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. I had my eyes closed.
So you like the expensive one. You have expensive taste.
Yeah,
that's great.
But...
Well,
but
now let's try
on
the
my
telephone
voice, thing. I don't hear it because you've got a richness down there that I don't have. Mm. So, God, there's so much. Tells you so much. Source material.
Yeah.
You know, I don't have... You're a bigger guy. You're going to have lower resonance. I don't have that in my voice. So I immediately like this because it brought out some low mids in my voice. Mm-hmm. Well, this may not have the low mids.
And for me,
definitely had some low lows.
Yeah, I needed more clarity maybe. So that's... Case in point.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Horses for courses, once again. But unbelievable for the price. And the same with that. For a rock and roll mic, and this is all just opinions, but it seems like probably a really popular rock and roll mic. So just for schnitz and schniggles, we decided to take off the reverb, just in case there was some additional resonance that the reverb is doing, which I think is smarvelous. But I'm going to have a quick double check.
Yeah.
111. 111. 111. Still has that. For me, it has that low mid on my voice. Now to Telefunken. 111111. 1222. 1222. 1222. 1222. I wish I knew the right words to describe this, but this feels more. If I say punchy, what I mean is it feels like it's like jumping out of me a little bit. Yeah. That's probably just better detailed mid-range.
Yeah.
Because our ears are going to hear like the high mids faster and the top end. That brings things forward. You know, that you know if you want to if you brighten something, it always feels like it's coming closer to you in the mix.
Yeah.
So my guess is that it's probably a nano more detailed in the high mids. Because for my ears at least, 1-2-2. It seems to pop, pop, pop. 1-2-2. I mean, that sounds great. 1-2-2. 1-2-2. 1-1-1. 1-2-2. These are slightly closer.
Mm-hmm.
Which it goes, because when we first did this, we liked the mid-range on this. We loved the low mids on this, and we loved the super lows on that. And these are all approximations, but this definitely has a bit of everything.
Yeah, you know, that's exactly right. I mean, not right or wrong, but to my ear, you know, I studied these microphones for so long when I made that video, and I had to listen to them over and over again to level match them and everything. But your read on that in, you know, the space of two minutes is exactly what I concluded after spending all this time with them. You know, these are quite similar. The Telefunken kind of has the best of everything.
Best of everything,
some richness in the low.
Assumingly most expensive.
It's also 9,000, yes.
Yes, okay. Well, I'm glad to see there's logic in this. So I see why this mic is doing really, really well, that it's very close to this, but nearly a third of the price. But I also see why there's validity in these two microphones because they also offer different kind of areas to fill in on a vocal. Like that for me, like this is amazing and yes, fantastic. This is super close to it. But maybe on my voice, not that I'm a singer, but maybe on my voice for the price, this is kind of a bargain for a singer like me. Because it fills in those low mids, which I don't have, because I'm not, hi, I'm Warren. You know, I don't have that gusto down there.
Especially when you start recording audiobooks, this will be perfect for you.
Yes, exactly. When I do my audiobooks. Well, I mean, let's think about the obvious things like C12s, I always like on girl singers. Mm. And they've always been very, very popular with R&B singers because they're sort, and again, generalization, but they're sort of like this.
Yeah.
They have a lot of lows and a lot of super highs. So for girls, it's great because it makes them feel a little richer. So if you've got a girl that's got a voice up here, it just kind of adds some lows in there.
Yeah.
So typically, I've always liked that. So, you know, you're making microphone choices, different types of microphones based on singers. Now you're making choices within one family of different styles of it.
Can we go to one thing that I think you and I both love about vintage microphones, and this is probably why we continue to be obsessed with them, why so many people clone them, is because it gives you something.
Sure.
It gives you, in some cases, a finished sound right from the beginning.
Right.
It flatters your voice, and that's a great thing, is to pick something that's going to be sort of the right kind of flattery
right.
matched with that singer. And so, you know, I love C12s myself, C24s, because they give you something right from the beginning.
Sure. Yeah. Well, I like a C12A sometimes.
Oh, yeah.
I have a pair of those. I really like those.
And you're a Queen fan.
Yeah. So I was about to say, Freddie Mercury's back. Right, yeah.
Elton John. Yeah.
Yeah. Hey, because we're always flying by the seat of our pants. Can we go to the slate and have it set to U47?
That's a great idea. Let me set that up.
Okay, great. So, you know,
I want a little background here. You worked with Stephen.
That's true.
For 2 years, and you were a part of the development of this little thing here, this Raven.
I created the Raven as a product and spent 2 years developing it. And you know, we had a very hardworking small team and
great.
Lived it, blood, sweat, and tears for 2 years to make something that hadn't been done before.
That's really fantastic.
It's awesome to see them out in the world.
Great. So, Stephen gave you a tip on using the 47 you were telling me. So, what do we do?
That's right, yeah. And I learned about this for my own shootout that I did, specifically on 47s. I wasn't listening to, I wasn't demoing, shooting out any other microphone models. But he told me that the proper gain staging, and he says it's in the manual. I haven't been a manual reader much, but that can be an important thing to do, especially if it gets you the intended results. So, Stephen over email told me that prior to the microphone model, you're supposed to set a minus 12 dB trim.
Yep.
And then...
This is just for the 47.
Just for the 47. We'll have to research that.
Okay.
And then post the 47, a plus 12 dB trim to make up for it. And let's double check that we've got the FG47 model. You know, fortunately, we have so many to choose from here, and they all do have their own personality. It's a really cool system. There's no doubt about it.
Now, what about the intensity? Where would you set that to be like an accurate representation-ish?
This is really fun. And you know, when we were in there testing the 47s a minute ago, I noticed that especially the low response changes quite a bit based on proximity, how close you are to the microphone.
Absolutely.
This is not a proximity control, but what I notice is that, let's say you love the Wonder because it had this rich proximity effect and enhanced the lows of your voice.
Absolutely.
Something similar with the Slate. You can have recorded your track already, and if you want more of that analog sound, whatever this model is bringing to that naked recording of the mic, because you do capture the raw, naked sound of a very kind of flat microphone, a very neutral, let's call it, microphone.
Sure.
And then what we're doing is applying the modeling of these various mic models on top of it. You know, starting at 100% is out of the gate, their idea of what...
Well, let's do this. Let's go and test this against the other one, see how we feel it, you know, listen to it, and then just whack up the intensity and see what it does.
Cool. Yeah, that'd
be
cool.
You know, proof of the pudding is in the eating.
Do you want me to drive while you test it?
No, let's both go in there.
Okay, cool.
Let's both go in there. So we're going to do it on 100.
1, 2, 2, 2, 1, 1, 1, 1. This has got good proximity. 1, 2, 2, 2. But I'm trying to stay the same in every mic. 1, 2, 2, 2, 1, 1, 1, 1.
Let's go to our expensive baby over here.
1, 2, 2, 2, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1. 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 2, 2, 1, 1, 1. 1, 2, 2, 2, 1, 1, 1, 1. 1, 2, 2, 2, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1. 1, 2, 2, 2, 1. 1, 2, 2, 2, 1.
Well, it's definitely got the lows, but then this one we felt had like the real mid-range. Mm-hmm. So this was our favorite for the lows on the Wonder, wasn't it?
For the low mid, sorry. 1, 2, 2, 1. 1, 2, 2, 1. 1, 2, 2, 1, 1, 1, 1. 1, 2, 2, 1, 1.
I don't know if it's... I would say, and now again... I would say the cardioid pattern's tighter on this than it is on this.
Mm, that's an interesting observation.
Go into it and you're going to hear, because there's not a lot of difference in the room, but you hear a little bit more ambience in this mic than you do in that.
Okay.
See what you think.
May I borrow your name again?
Please, whatever you want to do.
Warren Huart. Warren Huart. Warren Huart. Produce like a pro. Produce like a pro. Produce like a pro. Produce like a pro. Yeah. Great observation.
Yeah, this the Telefunken's cardioid pattern does seem a bit tighter.
It's just a little bit less. And the reason why I started thinking that way, because I feel like that I'm getting a little bit, look, but it's in a completely different position. So I don't want to be too judgmental when really they're not next to each other, but I do hear a little bit more. I feel this is less tighter.
And what do you think about the gain setting of the VMS? Because fortunately, the preamp for the VMS is right
there.
It's
pretty close, and definitely close enough for the test.
1, 2, 2. I mean, you tell me. It's probably, you know what? I got to reserve judgment because the AC is coming down here. So, and these are nowhere near that. So, well, at least they're not anywhere as close. So, I can't have any discussion about the cardioid pattern, but 1, 2, 2, 2. But I definitely hear a lot more ambience in this 1, 2, 2, 2. 1, 2, 2, 2.
I mean, it's, look, I mean, it's, I'm just going on a limb. Let's be honest. This is a, $1,000.
$1,000 system, yeah.
I don't really know what else to say. I mean, it's like there are differences between 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. If this, okay, let's go on a limb here. If this looked like this,
yeah,
and I was listening to it, I'd be going, wow, this is amazing. It's only $1,000. It's incredible.
Right.
You know, the rest of it's conjecture. We can say, is it a little bit like this or is it a little bit like that? It's really, really close. It has lots of characteristics of all of these. Mm. Definitely has a bit more mid-range punch, which is probably closer to these two. Mm-hmm. But I'm not sure. And I think my naive findings found that, that there was a little bit in some of the... And it's probably just because the mic it was modeled on. There was something missing at about 600-700. Did you hear that?
Yeah.
On the 47, there was like a 600-700 thing. Having said that, and I made this observation, I always pull that out of a vocal when I'm mixing. Right. It's like the "aw" that I don't like in a vocal.
Which would vary so radically from vintage example of 47 to vintage example.
Yeah.
And that's why I think it's when we're talking about the Slate mic, and now there's another clone, Sphere microphone from Townsend Labs.
Yes.
These emulations, kind of brand new territory. It's less important about it being an exact copy of, you know, any particular microphone, because all the vintage microphones sound different.
I have two, they're totally different.
Exactly. Yeah. So, you know, you have the fortune and benefit. This one doesn't have the honk that you don't like about your vintage 47.
You know, maybe the guys, when they were modeling it, maybe they chose the one that sounded good to them.
Right.
Which is the one that didn't have that 600-700E kind of thing that we often as mixers pull out.
Okay, which brings me back to the point of that all these microphones are tuned by a person.
Exactly.
These are companies, you know, largely run by a small team, and it's a brainchild of an individual who's like, I'm passionate about this. Right. And then they tune it to their ear and to their desire. And of course they send it around to people like you to get feedback before they release a product. But each one of these is tuned to something specific.
Sure. All right, I want to do the dumb clarity thing though. So here's my dumb clarity, and you can disagree with me. Mid-range punch, pretty darn close to the Telefunken down there.
Love it.
Mummy doesn't have the super, super lows. This has really good low mids.
And that's the CM7GS,
the
affordable of the Wonder
47. The more affordable.
Yes.
And then this is the more expensive version of the Wonder, which definitely has some beautiful low lows.
And a bit airier top end, I think.
Yeah, an airier top end, thank you. And this one seems to just win hands down, but the difference is negligible. I'll be honest.
Mm. And really, why would you call that the winner?
Yeah, I'd call that the winner as far as like all the mid-range detail, has the punch, the forwardness that the Flea has. But we have to bear in mind that, you know, this, look, it's a bit like good mastering engineers. You know about that? There's Pete Lyman upstairs, for instance. He's an amazing mastering engineer. There are so many really good mastering engineers that in this town will maybe master a song for $85, sometimes cheaper. Just going to go on. I'm not going to name any names.
All right.
And then you've got the big guys in town, which charge like $350 an hour. Now, the difference is a little better. Mm-hmm. Sometimes in life, you have to pay a lot more to get just that little bit better, because they're all working within certain tolerances. So like, this is definitely better. But is it going, this is for the connoisseur, you know, that's going to really appreciate that little extra difference of mid-range.
Let's bring this back to the question that you started with, which is, what motivates a customer to pick any particular mic over another one? And so sometimes a person might choose a mastering engineer based on that engineer's name brand.
Sure.
Because the perception that it might help them, you know, sure. get their music
he
out.
He did
where
Green
they want
Day,
to go.
Therefore I'm going to be huge.
Yeah, that, yes. that. And then also, how are they connected to their network? Who could they pass it along to?
Exactly.
Something similar with the Telefunken. Part yeah. Of why it's a more, well, more expensive and more sought after, it is a Telefunken.
Sure.
Through and through, it's an exact replica of a Telefunken. It's going to have a higher resale right. value. That's why someone might pay more for the name brand right. than another one. So, you know, I love it when we've done some blind tests of right. you know in this room. I love it when people don't know at all what they're listening to and they just choose purely on what they respond to.
Well, that was why it was nice when I closed my eyes yeah. and we tested those mics. I could. I did actually notice the difference. It scared me, but I like this in many ways because tight polar pattern, great rejection, you know, compared with the two mics here. Not that this was bad, because I think my U47 definitely picks up a little bit more ambience than my room than I would right. like. So that again is probably age, condition, mm-hmm. all that kind of stuff. So this might even be a better mic than mine. Who knows? I'd have to try it up against it. But one thing we ignored is so let's come back to the VMS. You know, like I said, if it was dressed up looking like this, yeah. we'd all be freaking out.
You know, and some of the polar pattern or the pickup differences that you noticed. I mean, mm-hmm. let's look at these mics physically. This is this mesh here is really thick, and mm-hmm. and the way that this is shaped, that's totally different than
sure.
the thickness and the layout of this mesh. And I mean, this 49 style microphone is part of its sound is definitely attributed to the shape of the microphone inside and the shape of this head grill. This,
right.
So at the end of the day, again, the comparisons are, it's more important. Like, what is this mic going to do? And what are you going to do with this mic? I think you can do a lot with this mic and any of these.
Yeah, I think, again, it's horses for courses. If money wasn't an object in any discussion and you had an unlimited amount, you'd probably just buy that to have it. If I was in this sort of in this area of which I kind of am, this might be a mic I would go for just to have a really yeah. good 47,
yeah.
which I know from you guys that is a really big seller. And you know, there's logic to stuff, you know. But honestly, if you want a mic that's just going to like do a million different things, because actually the thing I like most about this,
yeah, the slate.
Having used it, is the C12.
Mm.
I think okay. a C12 right. on it is so close to any C12, close enough that, I mean, what's a good vintage C12 go for these days?
In the mid-12s to mid-17s, depending right. on condition and.
Yeah, so, yeah, it's to have a mic that's got a pretty good 47 and a really good C12.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, I don't want to blow smoke up anybody's whatever, but yeah, it's definitely horses for courses. Yeah, I like this. I think this is a really good thing. Every single mic offers a different thing. Like you said, if a customer came in and went from one thing to another, yeah. depending on their voice, like me, they might go firstly to this one and go, oh, I like the way this makes my
right.
voice feel warmer.
Yeah.
And they're not going to like go and think like we just did and go, oh, the cardioid pattern on this
no.
isn't quite as tight as
no.
here. That's not going to matter. Especially if they were in a nice corner of a room where they deadened it out. Mm-hmm. It's irrelevant. So anyway, this is awesome. It's a lot of fun. I'm glad we were able to do this. So look, we did the 47s and yeah. I don't want to make this obviously the 47 shootout thing, but it becomes like that because it's the mic that gets so name checked.
Yeah.
You know, because it's on so many famous recordings and stuff like that. But there's a lot of beautiful microphones here and they're not all clones of anything. They're all their individual things.
Good point.
So let's just kind of listen to some other mics and then talk about them individually.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So what's this here? I don't actually know what this is.
100% Russian-built microphone by a company called Soyuz. And, Russians sent and continue to send people to space using some very basic technology. And
right.
one of the things that Soyuz tells us about is that they use machining equipment from mm-hmm. World War II to get this like micron level tolerance out of these mics. So they're all handmade
oh, wow.
on beautiful old Russian machinery, 100% made in Russia.
1-2-2-2-1-1. I mean, for me, that's kind of nice proximity. 1-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-1-1-1-1-1-1-1-1-1. I've got to ask, what's the sort of price range? 1-2-2.
I have to look it up. It's in the few thousands.
How much?
I'll have to look it up. It's a couple thousand dollars.
Couple thousand. Yeah. Okay.
Not too bad.
1, 2, 2, 2. 1, 1. It looks fantastic. It looks totally steampunk, doesn't it? There's definitely a lot of low popping that... So it sounds like it's got some really good super lows, but it also it's quite a lot of proximity. 1, 2, 2, 1, 1. I would say for me... Let me just hear something. 1, 2, 2, 2, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1. Sorry, Eric. I'm going to move over here. 1, 2, 2, 2, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1. There's not as big a proximity change on a mic on this mic. 1, 2, 2, 2. You hear it?
This is all just me speculating.
1, 2, 2, 2, 1, 1, 1, 1. But there's some serious lows in there.
There's some very serious low end in there.
It seems to love to grab your voice the closer you get to it.
Yeah, definitely. But it's very focused on that.
That's right, focused.
Yeah, so, which is, might actually be really, really good for miking things.
Mm-hmm. Like acoustic guitar.
Stagnant things, maybe. Mm. You know, people don't like to put condensers in high SPL areas, of course, but I wonder, maybe pull back on a bass cabinet. It might be pretty freaking awesome.
Cool.
You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
Or maybe stand-up basses or cellos or something where you want to get the riches. Mm-hmm. That could be pretty outstanding. That's where my brain would go to for that. Because I actually use my 47 when I do double bass.
Yeah.
You know, and well, sometimes I use the Lewitt LCT-940.
Does your 47 have a M7 capsule in it?
I have one that has an M7, one has.
Yeah.
Because one's a 48, which has the M7. Whereas the figure of eight, and then that's the old one. And then the newer one, late 50s, 58. Mm-hmm. I think that's been replaced. Because didn't they change about 60? 58?
I don't know the exact year.
I don't remember either.
And even with vintage mics, any of the original capsules have pretty much fallen apart at this
point.
Yeah,
the 48 one is...
Very, very rare to find one that's original. And you know, you can reskin them though, and they're amazing.
But it's got super lows. Awesome bottom end. I think... I'll just be honest. My only concern is with some singers that are like, hello, you know, like doing what singers do. You know what I'm saying? I'd be a little concerned about, but you know, EQ and compression, whatever. That would be my only concern because I do notice a large discrepancy.
That's a cool observation. You know, and people come in here with different goals, and you would come in here as a producer, rather than a singer.
Right.
And you're thinking about how is my artist going to work with this mic, not just in terms of the frequency response.
My artists, 200 different singers I'm going to have to work
with. Exactly, yeah. And you're thinking about what would work for them as they perform. Mm. That's a great thing to keep in mind.
But if the bottom end is so rich, there's a part of me that if I had all these mics to choose from so far, I might go, oh, this is the one I'm going to stick on the bass cabinet.
Cool.
As long as the bass cabinet isn't putting out horrendous SPL. This could be really awesome just to capture some super lows.
And again, that's like painting with, you know, from the microphone.
Yeah, but I don't, you know, again, we're sort of in this place where most people are probably going to buy one really, really nice large diaphragm condenser. Let's be honest, not unless you're a studio in your commercial facility, one or two large diaphragm condensers is a lot.
Mm-hmm.
Yep. So the Mojave, what can you tell me about this? Oh, this is inexpensive. $1,300, $1,295. For a tube condenser. It's exciting.
1, 2, 2, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1. This is nice. 1, 2, 2, 2. 1, 2, 2, 2, 1, 2, 2. 1, 2. 1, 2, 1, 2. 1, 2, 2, 2.
There's a 2K kind of thing in this as well. Mm-hmm. You hear that?
1, 2, 2, 2. 1, 2, 2, 2. This is a little smoother. 1, 2, 2, 2. Very subtle, but it's kind of an aggression to this, is actually. Now I'm hearing two things together. It's also kind of nice. 1, 2, 2, 2. 1, 2, 2, 2. It's like a little aggressive sounding. So I hate using adjectives. It's just, you know, it's back to that warmth and all those kind of things. One person's warmth.
I've had a lot of singers, they want air on their vocal, and they say to me, it's not warm enough. And my natural inclination is to think low mids and lows.
Right.
But a lot of guys and girls have said to me, I need it to be warmer. I put some more bottom end in. And they actually mean ambience. They want air on it. But so that's why adjectives are really scary.
It's tricky.
1, 2, 2, 2, 1, 2, 2. This is a good sounding mic. 1, 2, 2. 1, 2, 2, 2, 1, 2, 2. 1, 2, 2, 2, 1, 2, 2. 1222.
It's got a nice mid-range. Pure mid-range, like a 1K kind of hardness to it. You know what I mean? It's kind of nice. But wow, what a difference moving between mics. I don't know if it's modeled on anything in particular, but it's a great sounding mic for the price. Okay. And that's, so what kind of custom, what kind of customer's buying that at that kind of price?
Recently, I've had a few people who record their own acoustic piano who love that microphone.
Oh, so for pianos.
Yeah. And also, it's been a great drum overhead because kind of like, you're asking if it was modeled on anything. I don't know that specifically it was modeled on anything, but you know how a U67
right.
Tends to be a little bit more laid back in the top end?
And sure. Good mid-range.
But a warmer mic. That's the kind of neighborhood of that microphone, I think. The family of sounds, that U67 kind of sound.
Yeah.
More tapered off top end. But this one is a little airier than the classic 67.
It's definitely got some of the openness on it. But I like that mid-range push forward as well,
But doesn't have that coming at you, like kind of throaty sound of this microphone.
No, that one's definitely got some... I don't know if it... Hate this, I'm going to say it. Almost gritty. Like kind of just like... I made grit to it.
And would you say in a way that you could use as a texture?
Oh, goodness, yes. Yeah.
Yeah.
It's, again, it comes down to the unlimited funds and you've got great choices.
Just come in here to record anytime.
Okay. Do you hear that? He's inviting everybody to come in here and record.
1-2-2-2-1. 1-2-2-2-1. 1-2-2-2-1. I'm trying to get my proximity perfect. 1-1. 1-1. I think whatever I do, this definitely has more lows.
Is this a cheaper mic?
So non-tube,
non-tube.
That microphone.
Mm-hmm. Well, there you go. So that's got more lows, which people associate with transformers and tubes.
Yeah. And interestingly, though, the lows of the FET mic might be quicker or punchier. Mm-hmm. So this one may be saturating more in the lows and giving us that immediacy and richness. Whereas this may be, the FET mic is kind of classically used on a outside of a kick drum or bass
which
cabinet.
Which is kind of crazy, isn't it?
Yeah.
1-2-2-2. 1-2-2-2-1-1-1-1. It's a great sounding mic though.
So assumingly it's less expensive than this?
A bit, yeah.
Okay, cool. So it's the 1,000-ish?
Uh-huh.
Great. What is this? I don't know what this is. Probably everybody watching does.
Well, it's great. So Eric, who is on camera, he noted when we were setting levels, he said, Alex, I think there's an effect on that microphone. Is there a plug-in running or something? And this is meant to be an effect microphone. This is a copper phone. And it's meant to be like that old carbon microphone that you would have heard in an old telephone.
Now you got me excited.
Yeah.
1-2. Oh, yeah. The Martians are coming. I wish I knew War of the Worlds off the top of my head. It instantly makes me want to do Awesome Worlds. Wow. Oh, my God, the breathiness of it. 1-2-2-2-1. Mary had a little lamb. Her fleece was white as snow. 1-2-2. Wow. It's incredible. Who makes this?
I don't know the name of the
company. It's called a copper.
Yeah. Yeah, it's called a copper phone. You know, a cool trick that I've done with this is put it next to a real hi-fi condenser mic or tube mic and mix the two together. Just get those capsules lined up nicely. And this can be blended in to give you a bit of the grit that we heard in the Soyuz. Wow. You can blend it in, or you could say like you're going to a special section of the song.
It's got the grit in abundance.
Yeah. So you could combine them in a mix.
It actually a crystal mic or it's just made to sound like one?
Why not use a crystal? I think it is a crystal mic.
Oh, it is? Right. Wonderful. All right. So this is an old favorite of mine. The CMV 563 was always one of those mics that I loved. And
You and I have that history in common. My second great microphones I ever had, and I owned them for 10 years, were a pair of CMV 563s.
The originals.
Yeah. With the M7 capsule. I recorded everything with them. Vocals, acoustic guitar, overheads, rooms.
Yeah.
That room trick you're talking about is amazing with these. Yeah. I don't know
what
it is.
On the parquet floors.
Yeah.
Yeah. It was at Echo Park Studios in Bloomington. I have a strong affinity with the Midwest we're talking about.
All right.
So we made a lot of records there, like the Frey recorded there. Who recorded there? Everybody I worked with. We did a lot of records there. Mike Wanchek's studio, who plays guitar for Mellencamp.
Oh, cool.
Talk about Indiana. Indiana than... John Mellencamp. Let's see if my memory of this microphone actually matches how I hear it in my head.
1-2-2-2-1-1-1-1. I mean, it's a beautiful sounding mic. 1-2-2. 1-2-2-1-1-1-1-1. Wow. 1-2-2-2-1. Now, I'd like to hear it on your voice, Alex, because that sounds amazing. It definitely jumps and, mm-hmm. And does okay. the things that I love. But at the same time, this is so smooth sounding.
Yeah.
So even sounding. Is that a good way? I don't know.
Warren Huart, produce like a pro. Do I get the VO job? Can I do your
sure.
intro? Warren Huart, produce like a pro. Warren Huart, produce like a pro. Warren Huart, produce like a pro. Proximity, yes. So this is the Telefunken U-47. Gefell CMV-563. Gefell CMV-563.
Okay, so I actually love the way that sounds.
Yeah.
It sounds absolutely phenomenal. And in musical terms, maybe it's going to like bring the drums to life. So like the mid-range. But that sounds, I hate this, but flatter. It sounds a more consistent.
Mm.
Is that a good way of describing
broadband?
It? Yeah, broadband. There you go. But that kind of has like a this stuff going on. It feels like, I know why it's so good on room mics on drums.
And sometimes those inconsistencies or those non-linearities are exactly what we love.
Yeah, it's all about music, isn't it?
Yeah.
At the end of the day, we are capturing music, not sine waves. We're not putting out like 20 to 20K of white noise going, I've got to buy this because it's $10,000 and it captures the white noise. We're actually using things that we like coloring.
Should be all about inspiration. That's what I get when I walk into this room is inspiration. I want anybody who comes in here to gravitate to something that inspires them.
I think for me, it's making me, again, I love how this, because I don't have any fixed ideas and this is really changing it up. For me, I still want a pair of those. Because I feel like they just sound fantastic.
Yeah.
I'd love to put them on different things. I love a pair of those. And I'm still a kid. I look at it and go, it looks so cool.
It does.
There's a kid in me. And these are swappable.
That's right, yeah.
As well, so you can put different capsules on there.
The lollipop capsule.
Yeah. So that's all really cool. There's the big kid in me that loves this. But when I think as a studio owner, commercial studio owner, who is not worrying so much about money, I might just buy that. Because it's flatter. It's got a great frequency response from low to highs that you can hear across. And you know that if you're running a studio and you've got 100 different singers coming in, of all genres, that will work most of the time.
So not only more versatile, but also, as we were saying before, what would be a tiebreaker?
Yeah.
It could be a tiebreaker that if you, on your studio website, say, hey, we have a Telefunken U-47, a real one, that might bring people to your studio rather than another.
I love this because this is really, it's identifying customer base.
Yeah.
But if I'm a singer, and I'm not a lead singer, obviously, all joking aside, I'm not. If I'm a singer and I came in here, eyes closed, I'd probably buy this.
Mm.
And that was how much?
That's the Wonder CM7GS. That's in the mid threes.
So for value for money, it's obviously still expensive, but for value for money, that's the one that I felt made my voice sound the best.
Mm.
Because it filled in all my low mids that I don't have because I'm not a big boomy guy Alex.
You know, these microphones should make us more than we are. That's really what it's about. And recording, you know, it's like, why shoot on film versus digital or what have you? It's something that flatters, you know, something that makes us. What I think is cool about tube microphones is that, you know, tubes, as they distort, they compress a bit.
Sure.
They generate more harmonics. They're literally...
That's what I feel like is an abundance in this.
Yeah,
I feel
yeah.
like this is running super hot and there's a grittiness. I don't know if that's borne out in any electronic fact, but that's what it sounds like in the mid-range, like it's a little grittier.
And this is all the fact we need. That's all we're judging it based on. Yeah. But you know, it's adding music to what's there.
Yeah, it's back to horses for courses. That's why when people say to me, they ask me all the time, what should I buy? My first question is, what's your budget?
Right, yeah, mine
and
too.
Then what do you need it for?
Yeah, exactly.
If they're like, I'm a singer, or I just want to, or I want to open a commercial facility, then you have to balance it.
Yeah. Those are the best two questions to start with. That's what I always start with too. Yeah.
Well, good. So we've only got the Manly left over here.
Yeah.
Before we get round to these two. So.
And there's no Slate emulation of the Manly yet.
Right.
Just wait.
1-2-2-1-1-1. 1-1-1-2-2-2. Yeah, exactly. 1-2-2-2-1-1. I'm sorry to do this again, but I'm going to go from this to the 251. 1-2-2-2-1. 1-2-2-1. I think the AC is blowing into this corner a little harder. 1-2-2-1. Because I hear a bit more AC on it. 1-2-2-2-1. So for those of you listening back to this, bear that in mind that we're in a different position in the room. 1-2-2-2-1.
And that you create a lot of heat when you're in a room, right? Right, Warren?
Yes. 1-2-2-1. 1-2-2-2-1. 1-2-2-1-1-1-1. I know a lot of people that have this mic and absolutely love it. 1-2-2-1. 1-2-2-1-1-1. 1-2-2, 1-2-2, 1-2-2. It's pretty. Sorry, no pop screen, everybody. Have to bear with me on that. 1-1-1-1-1. It's pretty fantastic. What can you tell me about it? I've never actually used one of these in recording.
Ah, cool.
But so many people have them in their studio. So I am gonna just be like, I don't know. Tell me about it.
Sure. Well, people come in thinking of that as a pop vocal microphone.
And, oh, interesting.
You know, there's some folks, famous producers who've helped make this mic famous.
Who?
Well, like, I think often people, if they know, they'll say, oh yeah, isn't that what Dr. Luke used on Katy Perry?
Right.
So, you know, sometimes people come in with a kind of a preset thing in mind, like, okay, if I want that pop sound, I should use what people are using for that. And sometimes that's absolutely legit and it does translate. What I think is really cool about this as a tube microphone, it has kind of that essence of tubes, but yet where other microphones, especially when they're designed after kind of a vintage vibe, they'll begin to collapse a bit more, compress and sort of gently put a limit the more you throw into them. This Manly is unique in that it just keeps on giving. The more you throw at it,
That's a Manly characteristic.
Up.
Because
is,
that's
right.
The very Mew, which is like all the Manly gear I've ever tried. The very Mew is my favorite ever thing. Because you put guitars into it, or you put it on a mix bus, it just seems to tuck in the top end beautifully. It's like really good on harsh guitars. It's not quite like a Fairchild, which kind of makes everything much, you know, gets rid of some of that harshness completely. But it's really, really good at just taming the top end and sounding very smooth. So that seems to be a Manly characteristic. I think of very high spec components. Am I right?
High spec and tube yet clean and open. And this is also really known for how much top end is already coming out of the microphone, just out of the gate. But as opposed to something like a C800, which might have some sibilance issues, the Manly surprisingly doesn't produce, on most singers, too bad a sibilance. Or if it does, you can control it.
Sib. Is there a polar pattern control down here?
This is cardioid only.
Okay.
But on the microphone itself, there is a minus 10 dB pad, which we have engaged. So this thing can pick up just the most delicate subtleties.
It definitely seems to be doing that. I was wondering whether it wasn't in cardioid. 1-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2- Yeah, it's beautiful.
What are they ish price wise?
I think this is one of the best bargains in microphones in the
really?
World. I mean, it always shocks me that this is $2,700.
Oh wow! I thought you were going to say $5,000 or $6,000.
I know. That's what I think. It sort of it could easily compete with $5,000 microphones.
Wow!
Maybe one thing that helps keep the price under control is it's cardioid only.
Yeah, but like, when do I change my vocal mic out of cardioid?
Right, exactly. Yeah, it's a benefit for us. Yeah.
Yeah. Very smart. So, kudos to Manly for that mic. So it's good. I'm learning schnitzel. Like I've seen these everywhere. I never used them. Can you believe that? I've never used a Manly. Eva will be upset with me. But the very Muir you used 1,000 times. So this Wonder we didn't try. Now we're moving out. So what's this? Is it modeled after S67?
Good guess. Exactly. Yeah. Okay. And it's not an exact physical model of the 67, except for this is a bit of a giveaway.
This
head grill. Yeah. It has that
feels a little
look.
Wider. Mm-hmm. Feels like it's wider, like a
1-2-2-1-1-1, 1-2-2-2-2-1-1-1-1-1. It's good with the proximity. It's 1-2-2-2-2-2. I feel like I could get away with a singer. He's, you know what I mean? Where the other one there had a little bit too much change.
Oh, yeah.
This is good. 1-2-2. So it probably means, but it's interesting because that has less room tone in it. So you think the 251 that you would think that...
Oh, the 47 Telefunken?
Yeah, oh, sorry, not the 251. Yeah, the 47 Telefunken. You'd think that would have proximity issues having a tighter cardioid, but it doesn't. So 1-2-2-2-1, Go back to the 47. 1-2-2-2-1. 1-2-2-2-1. Definitely more aggressive mid-range. But that's, you know, that's why.
I remember when I worked with Steven Tyler, he had never sung on a 47. Can you believe that? Yeah, he had always recorded on a 67. Oh. And with James Cena, who's arguably one of the greatest engineers that ever walked the face of the planet, you know, working with Jack Douglas, they knew that they wanted that kind of aggression.
Yeah, that 47, upper mid.
Yeah.
Yeah, cuts through. Mm-hmm. Yeah, great for rock vocals.
So this is awesome. And what's the price range on this?
That's also in the $6,000 range. Yeah, that's a flagship Wonder mic. Spare no expense.
1-2-2-2-1-1-1-1-1. Yeah, I think it would be a great rock singer kind of mic because I could get away with a guy, you know, belting 1-2-2-1-1-1. There's a little difference, but
when a guy or a girl is performing, they're not like standing there like going, oh, you know, they're like, they're into it. And you want them to be into it. And, you know, like I tell every one of the apprentices I ever have, you know, it's our job to capture and not to restrict an artist's performance.
Yeah.
And that's why I think about microphones with proximity, because I think with massive proximity effect, because I get a concern that it's going to stifle my artist if I'm telling them, no, don't move too much. Or a little bit of that's okay. But when you've got young artists coming to the studio for the first time, of which some of the greatest artists are that, you know, all the people we love growing up, you know, just talking about this the other day, like Free, Andy Fraser was 15 when they made their first album.
Wow.
So, you know, coming in to make the first, you know, what are you going to do? Be like, oh, you can't do this. You know, you don't want to restrict your artist's performance.
And, you know, it's an honor to help someone through that first sort of.
Sure.
You're like a midwife, you know?
Right. Yeah, no, it's fantastic. Tell me about this.
So that is also from Flea, and that is their reproduction of a Neumann M49. So it's the Flea 49.
It looks so much like it. I didn't know what to call it.
Even down to the jewel.
Yeah, I didn't know what to call it. That's why I was like, tell me about this. Like, what is it?
1-2-2-2. I'm sorry that everything I'm doing is 1-2-2-2. 1-2-2-1. Mary had a little lamb. Mary had a little lamb. Mary had a little lamb. Mary had a little lamb.
Again, now, I really, really like this, but I like this on my voice.
Yeah.
Can you do it so I can hear you on them?
The 67 really flattered you, absolutely.
I'm just going to just...
It's almost like hand in glove. I'll do it as well.
Do it any order you like. Yeah, I want to say which one I prefer in your voice. I want to see if it's the same.
There we go. Don't look.
I'm not.
Warren Huart, produce like a pro. Warren Huart, produce like a pro. Warren Huart, produce like a pro. Warren Huart, produce like a pro.
The first one's smoother and more even. Which one was that?
That was the 49.
Yeah. Okay. Which is probably what you'd expect.
Yeah, more mid-range focus.
Yeah. Definitely, that one felt like I feel about the 563, like it was maybe a little bit more aggressive here and a little smoother there, but didn't feel like quite as full and flat. That feels full and flat to me. It's interesting. When you take yourself out of the equation, you hear differently.
And especially, do you find that it's a trick to, how much influence do you think there is on an artist's preference for a vocal mic? Let's say do you ever do mic shootouts when you're starting to work with an artist? You've like put up a few and then say, try this one.
No.
Okay.
I try not to.
Okay.
So here's a good thing, because then they get too emotionally attached. If I can keep them in a zone of performance
and
just go in and do the vocal, if I take them out of the zone, it depends. We're back in the days of unlimited budgets and the album took at least 6 weeks to make, which is pretty much every album in the 90s was like booked for 6 weeks. You go in with Fred Famous, the producer, and a great engineer, and you make a record in one studio for 6 weeks. I mean, so many albums were made that way. You would do the mic shootout early on in the process.
Yeah.
Because, you know, those records, especially the mid-90s, were like conveyor belts. They would do, the band would go in and track, they'd get the drum track.
That's right.
Then they'd do the bass or bass fixes.
Yep.
Then they'd do the heavy guitar overdubs or the guitar overdubs.
Yeah.
They'd do this, this, and this. And then the poor singer was left for maybe a week, sometimes 3 or 4 days to sing. So they may do the shootout at the beginning and then they're comfortable and they're in the vocal zone. We don't live in that world anymore. So I personally, and this is just my opinion, everybody can tell me I'm wrong, I like to to not do that process because it slows down everything, takes them out of the zone. I like to always be moving. Mm-hmm. And I have a couple of go-to mics that I know sounds great.
Yeah.
And I make the decision. And,
yeah.
And personally, over the last few years, I haven't had anybody question it. Even from Tyler, he just wasn't used to using that microphone. Mm-hmm. Ace Frehley obviously is not a world famous singer by any means. He would be first one to say that, but he never asked me what mic it was.
Right.
You know, and then the younger artists come in trusting me. They never ask me what it is. But obviously, if I pull up my 47 or my 940 and it doesn't work, then I change it. Mm-hmm. But you know what I mean? It's like it's a catch 22. We did that when we did the Phrase second album because we were in Sausalito and it was like we were in there for 3 months.
Wow.
And they had 4 47s.
Wow.
Of similar vintage. Two of them were not quite consecutive serial numbers, but they were all of the same vintage. And each mic had a story. This mic comes up and I can't remember the guy's name who ran the studio. Anyway, he put up this mic and he brought it out and he's like, this is the Songs of Key of Life. This is Stevie Wonder's mic. Then he came out and he goes, this is the one they used on Rooms.
Yeah.
And then this one, and every mic had like a story.
Metallica.
Yeah, whatever it was. You remember the plant in Sausalito. So they all had a story. And some of them obviously had done, this one mic had done like 4 huge albums.
Yeah.
Anyway, all that being said, I then went through a 1073 through my usual compression chain, the same 1073. And all I did was like patch, 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 patch. You have not heard 4 more different mics in the whole of your life.
Yeah.
And 2 of them were like almost consecutive within probably a week of being made in the same factory. Wow. And it was condition, all these different things, all these amazing different factors. But I honestly, if you closed your eyes and I told you they were all 47s, people would be like,
that's right.
That doesn't sound like a 47. And my response is like, well, what is a 47? I have no idea. Because these are all 47s and they're all famous mics, whatever that means.
Any more a vintage microphone just is what it is.
Yeah. Yeah.
They've all taken detours over time.
So between clones, remakes, you know, new remakes. And Stevens, it's great that we're doing this because, that people are manufacturing this because there is no constant anymore. You know, there is no like, here's the pristine 47. I don't know if I would like that one.
Never know. Yeah.
Because I like the 48, which is super, super dark and probably the capsule's about to explode on.
Right.
But that was used on Adele's Someone Like You.
Mm.
So, and How to Save a Life by the Fray. So am I going to say that microphone is not good? Even though it's super dark,
right.
It doesn't have the air and the top end of any of these microphones.
And if I can say something about dark and bright, some microphones that sound dark to us just with no processing take EQ well.
Right, that's a good point.
You can add top end for days and it will continue to be smooth and flattering.
Right.
So I try to help people understand that.
That's a good
especially
point.
With a digital EQ, if it's a good one, it's clean.
Sure.
They can take something that sounds dark to them, but has maybe all the other qualities that are flattering to the voice.
Right.
Add the top end in that they need and it's going to sound great.
This is awesome. Yeah, that's a good point. We're covering a lot of stuff here. Okay, well, we've got a handful of mics to get around here. Are you ready for the challenge, Eric? Okay, so we're going to move around these last remaining mics here. And a couple of things. This is a Paluso, isn't it?
$1,000 version of a U87, essentially.
I have a 47 and a 67 of his.
Okay.
And they're remarkably good for the price. So I've never heard this one.
1-2-2-1-1-1-1. Do we have an 87 in here?
Yes, we do. Right there.
There it is. Right in front of me. Yeah.
Really obviously in front of me. 1-2-2. 1-2-2-1-1. 1-2-2-2. 1-2-2-2. 1-2-1.
So this has got like a lot more high mids. As soon as I did that, heard it.
Yep.
It was like, whoa. Because I was trying to think out, what am I hearing a lot
That's
more
right.
of?
Yeah.
So when I did that, I wanted to hear that 3 to 5K
right.
super ear sensitive area that we all have. And that's got that in abundance.
Do you hear that on your other Paluso microphones?
A little bit.
Yeah.
I am a huge fan of Paluso.
Yeah.
Just because going back to the sort of philosophy, the guy is making it in a little town in the middle of nowhere.
Yeah.
Did you hear that PBS thing on him? They did a podcast with him and they drove out to him.
Oh, cool.
The guy had to like fly and then land and drive for like 2 hours to find where he was. And it was him and his wife making these.
On a seaplane landing on a small lake.
Something like that, yeah. It was crazy. But to me, it's just value for money. And I'm going to say that this is a little bit more aggressive in the high mids, and it's not as smooth as an 87. Yeah. And I'm going to leave it as that, because that's a $1,000 microphone. And how much is that?
And $3,500-ish. Yeah. And
beautiful mic.
Yeah. I mean,
an industry standard. And probably, again, you talk about flagship and studio ownership.
Yeah.
There's where an 87 is going to be one of those mics. Yep. It's going to be like, if you own a studio and you want a constant that people may have heard of, not that everybody's an expert, having an 87 in your arsenal. When I had my first studio in LA, I bought an 87.
Absolutely.
And that was the first,
very smart,
quote unquote, real mic I had.
Expensive. You owned a Neumann.
I owned a Neumann. And then those days it was $1,800, not $3,500.
So, and besides musicians and singers who come in here, we also work with a lot of voiceover artists, helping them find a good mic for them. And that's one of those things that whoever's hiring that voiceover artist might want to know that they have a Neumann U87, because that's the industry standard. It gives them a bit more confidence in who they're hiring. And also it says something about that person. Can they afford, you know, the $3,500 mic? Right. That sort of legitimizes that voiceover artist.
Now, there's a guy I produced who's a good friend of mine called Jamie Hartman. Mm. He's been on the show. I don't know if he's ever been here. Jamie wrote a worldwide smash, current work by a guy called Rag and Bone Man. It's not, you hear three left sets. He just talked about it 2 days ago. This was he wrote that song with the singer, and his song's called Human. It's like number one in like 8 countries. And when I produced his solo record, I put up my 47. Actually, it was the 48 that we had done Adele on. My engineer had done Adele. Mm-hmm. So,
and by the way, if anybody hears anything in the background, this is an active showroom. There's customers out there. There's our technician, Michael Westbrook, is out there setting something up. And
good.
If you hear any background noise, through our lavalier mics.
Hustle and bustle.
Yeah.
So Jamie is like this. He's a great singer. And so I just want to use this as a case in point. So I like put up the 48, and he's like, I don't know if this is going to work. And I was like, what do you mean? This is the famous mic, blah, 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 you know. And he's like, I don't know. He puts it up and there's no logic to it. It is the worst sounding vocal I've ever recorded in my life. And he's right. He goes, give me a 414. I'm like, really? I'm like, you know, so I go to the mic locker in Harmony and I pull out a generic 15-year-old.
Right.
You know, what is it, $1,000, 414, put it on the stand, and it's like beautiful. And I'm like, I mean, I know these mics are different and they're very, very different, but the results were so phenomenally different, totally unusable on a U48 to being fantastic sounding on a 414. Vintage $15,000 mic, $1,000, you know, generic bought from Guitar Center 20 years ago.
Oh, believe me, I get attached to microphones in this room and I have my favorites. And sometimes when folks come in to do their own demo, I really am rooting for, you know, the Telefunken 251.
And
but for them, you know, it's the, what, $1,600 Dave Perlman TM1. You know, that's just, it's magic for them.
So I think, I like that. I feel like we're, you know, again, this is one of the reasons I like to have these discussions. Like, this is a beautiful sounding mic, definitely. But it's got it's part of its cachet, like the 251. The 47, sorry. There's a 251, we went past it, sorry. I mean, actually, we haven't got to this yet, but these microphones is that you've got the ability when you're a studio owner to say, I have an industry standard.
Yep.
But what I was saying is this kind of sounds like a little bit like the what happened to Jamie's voice. And I wonder, a mic like this might sound incredible on him. You'd be surprised. It's really weird. And again, if I was coming in as a singer, I mean, this is incredible value for money. It's horses for courses. Definitely. How many times have I said that today? Okay, let's go to the 251.
I like it every time you do.
1-2-2-2-1-1-1-1-1-1-2-1-2-2-2. Okay, so immediately, I mean, anybody can hear the lows in this are pretty phenomenal. 1-1-1-1-1-1-1-1.
I mean, this is probably quote-unquote flatter, whatever that means, but this has got some...
Yeah.
Some girth. Again, I'm using adjectives, but yeah. Let's go over here.
1-2-2-1-1. Let me just get that centered a little bit more. 1-2-2-1-1-1. 1-2-2-1.
Great. I'm glad you're comparing these.
Wow.
1-2-2-1. 1-2-2-1. 1-1-1.
Go do it for me, because I'm going to tell you. I want to see if I can hear a difference. Or how much of a difference?
Okay, blind.
Blind test? Yeah.
Okay, here we go. spin around three times.
Then I'll be dizzy and fall over. We only had 3 hours sleep from working last night.
Warren Huart, produce like a pro. Warren Huart, produce like a pro.
And again, please.
Warren Huart, produce like a super pro. Warren Huart, produce like a superstar pro.
I didn't know whether you changed in the middle, did you?
I've only done one change.
Oh, you did one change. Okay. Do it one more time for me.
Okay.
Warren Huart, produce like a super pro. Warren Huart, produce like a super pro.
Next.
Warren
Huart. Am I in the right one?
Warren Huart, produce like a super pro.
Do me a favor. Do it just because ear memory is not that long. Just totally. Go like Warren Huart, produce like a pro, then go to the next one.
Cool.
Because I'd be lying if I could tell with that much difference.
Awesome. Here we go.
Warren Huart, produce like a pro. Warren Huart, produce like a pro.
I mean, they are so similar, it's ridiculous.
Pretty amazing.
It's insane. And so I don't know which one I prefer. I felt like in that test, maybe, and it's probably proximity, there was a little bit more lows on the first one you did there, but maybe that might have just been your head being 3 millimeters closer.
And while we did our best to match the gain before we started, even the smallest little bit of gain difference could make you favor one over another.
It's just, I don't know which one was which.
On that last test, the first one was the Bach
251. I was in the back of my mind because of the lows thinking it might have been that.
Oh, yeah.
Wow. So, all right. So now tell us what the price difference is. Sorry, Telefunken, if it works out, it's more expensive.
$6,000 range made here in Los Angeles.
Wow.
David Bach used to have Sound Deluxe. In fact, they brought back...
Oh, I remember Sound Deluxe. They were great.
Yeah. So lots of great Sound Deluxe mics still out there in the field working great. And
I'm dying to know that. How much is this?
And this is $8,500 or $9,000. So it's right up there. Another flagship Telefunken mic.
Oh, it's amazing. But so sorry, once again, this is how much?
About six.
Six and eight or nine?
Yes.
You can draw your own conclusions to that. Yeah. And this is fine. Now it would be like, do you buy a microphone based on the fact that when you got your listing?
Yeah.
God, I'm sorry, Telefunken, but when you, or anybody, you know, when you go to the website, do you want to list the name Telefunken? Or do you want a microphone that's sounds incredible and costs less money, but sounds just as good?
And
did I just say that out loud? I'm sorry, but that, maybe there's some magic people with magic ears that can hear the audio things and can say one over the other, but that's why I had to get you to do it, because I couldn't hear a difference that was like jumping out to me. Mm-hmm. That's pretty special, that Bach.
I love the Bach mics. And something happens too. I mean, that's how it responded on our voices speaking. Mm-hmm. You know, everybody has their own unique voice.
Yeah, it didn't
overtones.
Do that difference. Like a lot of these microphones, you sounded better on one mic and I sounded better on a different mic. Yeah. But this one, we both responded in the same way to our voices. Mm-hmm. Which is pretty remarkable. I mean, now, taking away the simulation, because that's not fair to compare because we haven't done that. But now I feel like if I was walking in here and I just had a checkbook, that might be the mic I'm walking out with.
Nice.
Do you know what I mean? Because it's flat. It's working on every source. We've got two completely different voices and I'm really liking it. And we're not advertising Bach here, but that's, you know, again, it comes down to price, but just on, wow, I don't know if I like to say all this on camera quite so resolutely, but you probably could feel quite confident selling that to people.
And 251. Yeah, the 251s, that sort of a style of microphone is known to be great on such a wide variety of singers and even sources like piano or room mic.
Yeah.
Yeah, very cool.
Very cool.
And they're also known for their reach. 251 is known to sort of reach out and grab the source. And I think that's partly what gravitates singers toward them.
Yeah. I wonder what the charts tell us on the frequency responses. Who knows?
The charts we don't care about.
The charts we shouldn't care about. Yeah, I agree. Okay, so what is this, Alex?
That's a Lawton, really affordable tube mic, under $1,000. What does that say? The LA320, the Lawton Audio 320. Yep. It's cool sounding, man. It has a lot of soul for a very affordable mic.
1, 2, 2. Oh, yeah, that does sound good. 1, 2, 2, 2, 1.
Let's go to our new control.
Oh, yeah.
1, 2, 2, 1. 1, 2, 2, 1. Wow. 1, 2, 2, 1. Mary had a one. One.
I mean, again, it's the quote-unquote expensive mics.
Yeah.
They all seem to have an evenness to them.
And a smoothness to the top end. I find that's one of the biggest differences. Yeah.
But I feel like with most of the mics, what I'm hearing when they're, I don't know, not the incredibly expensive ones, is sort of the mid-range changes, especially in the low mid modes and stuff. It seems to change.
Mm-hmm.
And a pure mid-range, like the 1K, like real mid-range.
One, two, two. But this is, you're right. It's very crispy at top, isn't it? One, two, 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 one. Yeah.
Like you say, this smoothness. This definitely has a little bit more mid-range bite. But that might, I just said bite. Should have said that. But it definitely has more mid-range. But that might well be because it doesn't have quite the lows and the low mids.
Right.
So instead of it being necessarily boosted, there, it might just have,
yeah.
So, but you're right. If that's less than $1,000, then that's a pretty darn good microphone.
Next up is a Royer 12221. It's a ribbon. It's a little darker. Doesn't have quite the brightness on the top end. It's a ribbon mic. I mean, it's difficult
in all fairness to judge it against all these condensers that have these extended top ends and stuff like that.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
And let's do a little educational moment. Let's
please.
Let's do put a pop filter on it, because the one thing about, you know, people ask, you know, is a ribbon going to be something I'm just going to blow up? Is it too delicate for me to own? And the answer is no. The thing that ribbons are most susceptible to are gusts of wind, wherever they're coming from.
So don't fart on your mic. Oh, I'm watching Eric. Hey, it's been a long day. And we worked till 3 o'clock in the morning.
Let's try that.
So look at this.
And
I still know how to put a pop screen on after all these years?
And this applies also to when you're taking them down, carrying them across the room. You have to be careful of wind blasts. You don't want to swing that ribbon mic around and...
One, two, two, one, 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 one. Yeah, I think 12221.
I think in all fairness, I like the way it sounds. I know the Royers very, very well. They're sort of a modern standard with like a 57.
Oh, yeah.
For certain types of recording, especially here in LA, so many of the producers and engineers I'm friends with have a Royer and a 57 on every guitar amp they ever record.
Yeah. Always blending them or like favoring one or the other, choosing the mix?
Exactly. It used to be years ago, 421s and 57s.
Yeah.
When I first started, it was a 421 and a 57 next to each other, blended, which still a lot of people do. But now, more often, I see 121s or 122s with a 57. So, next up, SM7.
1222 sounds like an SM7, like all honky and aggressive and great for rock. Wah, two. Yeah, it's like...
Actually, that 700 blew my head up.
Sorry,
when I went, wah, it was like, whoo. I apologize. But yeah, it's what we expect from an SM7. Lots of mid-range, cuts through, great over the top of loud rock guitars.
Limited detail, which you can use to your advantage. That's
exactly
one of the things. Yeah, if you have someone you just want to capture kind of the intensity of the yell, without getting into too much of it, something that can become harsh and some high-frequency detail, that's it.
Right.
And you can grab the thing. You can have a singer just grab that mic and actually perform into it. It's got... The capsule is actually kind of back in here somewhere.
Yep.
If you take this wind screen off, so it's got a built-in windscreen. It's a great performance microphone.
Yeah, I know guys that swear by it for rock and roll. I'm sure they use it for other genres as well. I've seen them in all kinds of situations.
1-2-2. So this is the Gefell you were telling us about earlier. 1-2-2-1-1-1.
Go back to our
1-2-2-1-1-1. One, two, two, one, 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 one. It's pretty darn good. One, 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 one. One, 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 one. There's definitely a
little bit more output on that at the moment than this one. But pretty even sounding. I mean, what's the price range on this? And this, you said, is tube, you said earlier.
Yeah, it has a Phantom powered tube in it.
Oh, wow.
The price is in the $4,000 to $5,000 range. And I liken that to the Manly a bit, in that it's a tube mic, but it's also clean and open sounding. Yeah.
That makes sense.
It's not going to compress as much as some other microphones. Great for instrumental recording.
Beautiful.
Yeah. And vocals.
Jazz and orchestral brings to mind, doesn't it? Sort of very clean, open, beautiful sounding.
Okay, so here we have the Peluso 67. So, okay, we're going to try something a little crazy.
Yeah.
Sorry, Eric. 1-2-2-2-2-1. 1, 2, 2, 2, 1, 1, 2, 2. 1, 2, 2. 1, 2, 2, 2. Wow, that's... 1, 2, 2, 1.
One, wrong one.
1, 2, 2.
You want to do a blind test?
Do a blind test.
All right.
That's pretty darn close for... I know there's a price differential because I know Paluso pricing.
Okay, so turn some way where you can't tell where I am.
Yeah.
Get the blind test.
All right, I'm going to... No reflection, so don't know where you're starting from.
Warren Huart, produce like a pro.
It's killing me.
Warren Huart, produce like a pro.
Okay, so wherever you went first definitely had some really big fat lows.
Yeah.
Okay, good. So I'm glad. That's probably that time differential for me moving in there.
Yeah.
And it's easier to hear on your voice with more lows. I don't have those lows. So I'm assuming you started there, yeah?
I started there.
That would have freaked me out.
I didn't know that it was the wonder first, yes.
Yeah, okay, cool. So that makes a little bit more sense. That would have been really freaky if
yeah.
Because my voice doesn't, and this is it, sound sources, my voice doesn't have those lows. So I didn't hear the difference between those two. But as soon as you did it on your own, the low lows on the first one were so much richer.
Let me do one more.
Yeah.
Because let's focus on some other frequencies, okay?
Please.
All right, blind test. Close your eyes.
Sibilant sound sources suck. Sibilant sound sources suck.
I mean, that second one sounded quite a lot more richer in general, as well as the top end. So, yeah, the sibilance on the first one was greater. Where'd you start?
I started on the Paluso this time. Right, yeah.
Yeah.
And part of that is, like, if there's a weightier mic, it's going to reduce your perception of the sibilance.
Sure, exactly. Yeah, it's like we were talking about when it might not be that one mic is brighter or significantly less or more in the high mids, but if there's less low mids, then those are going to feel more pronounced.
But that is, again, something that I see as a constant across the budget mics. If there's going to be one place where they're shorter of the more expensive mics, is in the smoothness of the top end.
So this is an amazing sounding mic that we love.
Yeah.
And this is a really, really good mic.
Really
for the
good
money.
One.
Because I know I do love the Paluso stuff. Can we get it on camera here a little bit?
Let's do it.
Because, so here it is. So this is what we're talking about. So we're talking about this Paluso here. How much is this?
In the $1,000 to $2,000 range, yeah.
So it's pretty darn good.
I had some guys come in from Argentina and they tried every mic in this. And, you know, they were looking for an affordable microphone, but they just kept coming back to that one. It sounded amazing on everything they did.
I think if I was going to go for a 67 type of microphone, it would be hard for me to spend what you have to spend. I used to have a 67. And I bought it from Johnny Resnick when they had that fire sale a few years ago and he just got rid of all the studio stuff. And we got a really good deal on it, but it became the point, and this is terrible to say, people will hate me for this, came a point that I didn't use it enough that it was worth the money that it was worth.
Right.
Because we got such a good deal and we sold it.
Did your investment actually...
I don't want to tell you what I paid for it. It was so cheap. So by the time we sold it, it just made more sense because I love 67s, but I wasn't using it every day like I was using a 47.
Well, and again, that's another thing that what makes someone buy this one versus that one.
Right.
If it has the name, and especially if it's vintage, it will likely increase in value.
Yeah, we make quite a lot of money back off it. So it was definitely a good investment for us. But I think that comes down to like why people like the Slate. Because like I was saying, you know, the C12 sounds so close, but it's a fraction of a fraction of a fraction of the cost.
Yeah.
Replaceable. And replaceable.
If you, for some reason, dropped it, or your girlfriend tipped over your mic stand, or your boyfriend tipped over your mic stand, you could replace it.
Absolutely. Great. So wonderful value for money. Always loved Paluso. I remember dealing with them on the phone years ago, and just a joy to deal with them. Okay. So that's always good as well. Okay, so we got two left.
Yeah, Manly Reference Gold.
This is Kyle Lenning has one of these and swears by it, and he's one of the best country producers ever.
Good, and let's check the pattern. How are your eyes? Can you see? That looks cardioid to me.
Yeah, it's down there, cardioid, omni to the left, figure eight to the right. Is that correct?
Continuously variable. This is the only microphone I know where it's a continuously variable
pattern.
Pretty
centered.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Right on the mic. It's pretty cool.
Beautiful.
One, two, two. Wow. 1-2-2-2-1-1-1.
Going back to the Telefunken.
1-2-2-2-1-1-1. 1-2-2-2-1-1-1.
How about the Bach?
Yep, thank you.
1-2-2-2-1-1-1. Bong.
So, let's hear it with your voice.
Okay, good.
Produce like a pro with Warren Huart. Produce like a pro with Warren Huart. Produce like a pro with Warren Huart.
Okay, I want to do a blind test. They all sounded remarkably good.
Yeah. Yeah, that's so good.
Produce like a pro with Warren Huart. Produce like a pro with Warren Huart. Produce like a pro with Warren Huart.
I was a little off on one of them.
Obviously the 251 that you're about to. So that was that the middle one that didn't have quite the lows.
Yeah, I was off axis a little bit.
So we can we can definitely hear it. Yeah, there was like the middle one didn't have quite the lows. So do it one more time because the first and third sounded so similar to each other.
I'll mix up the order.
Yeah.
Produce like a pro with Warren Huart. Produce like a pro with Warren Huart. Produce like a pro with Warren Huart.
Okay, can I hear one and three again?
Produce like a pro with Warren Huart. Produce like a pro with Warren Huart.
Now give me the middle one again.
Produce like a pro with Warren Huart.
They're all fantastic. That middle one is like there's a little tiny bit more mid-range, just like a Nats cock ball.
Right.
is that the Bach?
It was, yeah.
Okay, cool. So I don't know. This is, sorry people, I don't know which was a 251, which one was a Manly.
Okay. You want to take a guess?
No. Give me one, just go between those two and see if I can guess.
Got it.
So we know which one it's not. So,
produce like a pro with Warren Huart. Produce like a pro with Warren Huart.
Goodness, one more time.
Produce like a pro with Warren Huart. Produce like a pro with Warren Huart.
The lows are very slightly more. Is that on the 251? Just like the Nats more, but it's so slight. I don't know if that's proximity or not.
Yeah,
I felt like I had two different results. If you did it the same way both times, did you do it the same way both times?
Mm-hmm. In order?
Yeah.
No, I flopped the order. Yeah.
Okay, so yeah, I had no point of reference. I felt like that's why I wanted to do it again.
This last time I did, it was 251 first. And then Manly.
And then the other way around. Mm-hmm. Okay, yeah. Yep. So that's why that confused me. I mean, those both sound absolutely fantastic.
I never would have put those two together.
Yeah.
But hearing them back to back, there's a lot of similarity.
A lot of similarities. Isn't that crazy?
Yeah. I think happen...
look, I'm on these 7506s. When we hear back the WAV files through proper speakers, you're going to hear a lot more differences than you can with just these on.
And I think what's going to happen with a Singer is that the Manly, like we were talking about with other Manly gear, it's cleaner, clearer. It tends to open up like the reference cardioid Manly microphone. The more you lay into it, the more
it just keeps on giving. How does it sound in the Audio Technicas compared to...
And this one's going to like kind of compress more, like a vintage mic. Yeah. You want to switch headphones?
Yeah, I want to hear what it sounds like through those. We kept to the cheap headphones because that's more realistic, but... there's a part of me that realizes that through huge full range monitors, we're going to hear a lot more subtleties than you can hear through these headphones.
Okay, we're doing it blind. Do you have an order, please, preference? Yeah. Okay, cool. I'm going to switch it up.
So the 5 hour long video.
Produce like a pro with Warren Huart. Produce like a pro with Warren Huart.
Okay, so suddenly, yeah, the low lows on the Manly for this are mm-hmm. so much more pronounced. Mm. So it's definitely the headphones. These obviously have a completely different response to
yeah,
those.
Yeah, they do. Yeah.
So that's the biggest difference now that you can't. Could you not hear it as much on those? It's crazy.
Exactly, the lows I couldn't hear as much.
Yeah, yeah. 7506s. So there's definitely a huge richness mm-hmm. in that Manly, mm-hmm. which is pretty incredible. Nice. So, wow, I don't know what that makes it better or worse than me because I probably end up rolling all of that out, but I can see why Kyle Lanning thinks that that's an incredible mic. Mm-hmm.
And it seemed like the Manly was, its ears were bigger.
Yeah.
Like you were saying, this has a little bit more focused sound.
Yeah.
And the Manly was just kind of a little broader, like pickup-wise, pattern-wise.
Oh, yeah, I probably kept my head in one place, but yeah, which is also good.
But we're on cardioid.
We're on cardioid. So, yeah. Between that, I mean, I didn't dislike the slight additional mid-range from the Bock. Mm-hmm. Now, and it doesn't, it's not as noticeable between these two, but it's mm-hmm. once you throw the Manly in, it gives you like a, you know, what do they call that? Where you throw a third thing in.
A control.
Thank you. Yes. All right, let's go to the swap back on this just because I'm used to it. Mm-hmm. And let's check out this last mic here.
Cool.
I mean, I think all that for me told us is that these three mics are all phenomenal.
Absolutely.
You know, I think it's like horses for courses once again. It's like, you know, I'm not going to fight over somebody telling me the Gold is a better mic for that. There's a better mic than this. They're all unbelievable. Okay, so the Pullman. I have used one of these and they are great. Mm-hmm.
1, 2, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. But I'm so used to hearing your voice on it for the last 5 minutes, so I'm missing all the lows. Will you go on it?
Mm. I'm so used to hearing your voice on it for the last 5 minutes. Could we put your voice on it?
So you're Irish?
Oh, man, sorry. I'm doing my best.
There's the bottom end.
Born in the Midwest.
Yeah.
Produce like a pro with Warren Huart.
And go to the Manly.
Produce like a pro with Warren Huart.
I mean, how much is that? Like, that's the difference of...
It's under $2,000.
Under $2,000. Yeah. What's the Manly-ish?
Five. Yeah.
Oh! Mm-hmm.
What, do you have a new favorite in the room?
I mean, for $5,000, it's a lot of money. Because it's $5,000, but it's not like a lot of money. I would not have put, just being a consumer, I would not have put the Manly and the 251 that.
Right.
Like the 8.9 and the 5. I thought you were going to say like 8.9, 8.9.
Right, yep.
So even though that's a lot of money, $5,000 is a lot of money, that Manly now starts to look very sexy.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And the Bock is very sexy at the price as well. And the Pullman's great for the money, but that's a tough one. Yeah, new favorite in the room. So what's the Manly and what's the Bock? What's the difference in the price between those? Ish.
Manly's about 5 and the Bock is about 6.
Yeah, I'd be hard-pressed between those two for value for money.
Yeah.
Taking away the VMS because I still think that that's, you can't really beat that for value for money. Just can't. But in for that, yeah. Wow, I love being able to do this. I've learned so much.
It's so fun. Every time I get to do a demo with a customer, I learn something new and it's...
I still wonder if this is the best mic for my voice.
1, 2, 2, 1, 1, 1.
Let's go to the Manly.
1, 2, 2, 2, 1, 1, 1. 1, 2, 2. 1, 2, 2, 2, 1.
Yeah, there's a little bit too much low mids compared with that. But if I'm coming here as the singer and you're saying to me, even at $5,000 for an incredible mic for the price, what's this?
Sorry, that's 3,600 about. Yeah, this is the affordable Wonder 47.
It's open to conjecture. It really comes down, like, now I'm like looking at it like, you know, do you spend the extra? But you know that it's going to be great for your vocal. And there's going to be guys and girls that are going to come in here and go, that's my mic, that's my mic, that's my mic. There's going to be the mic that fits their voice. Yeah.
Painting with sound.
Painting with sound. Thank you very much, my friend.
Oh, my pleasure, Warren. Thanks for being here.
That went from a 20-minute video to a 17 and a half hour week.
There was a lot to cover. Can you guys edit a little bit?
Yeah.
Okay.
Maybe we should. Yeah. Me. I don't know if I can edit out you going, Warren, you're a producer, like a pro. There's a lot of eye rolling, you know. So there's a lot of conclusions. I think for me, and you can correct me at any point, my conclusions are that if I'm a singer, I'm going to come in, I'm obviously going to gravitate towards different mics for my voice. Because that sort of $3,000 mic actually sounded just as good on my voice
as like a $9,000 mic just because I don't have those super lows. So I didn't hear that warmth. Mm-hmm. But if I'm a studio owner, I'm going to look at something which is a lot broader and has, you know, a massive frequency response and is much flatter to work with independent singers of different voices. So that's one thing I think for everybody to think about. Then we were also talking about brand recognition. Mm. So if you're a studio and you want to have a really cool looking mic locker, you're probably going to lean towards 87s because they are an industry standard, the U87, totally understandable. And then probably the Telefunken because you've got the cachet. Now, if you are looking for value for money, then the Bock comes out swinging. The 251 sounds pretty darn good. On your voice, I could barely hear anything, which was freaky. On mine, I didn't even know if there was a difference. But on yours, it was because you have a little bit more low lows, the subtlety was there. But then the Manly, I thought was a $10,000 mic, and we just looked it up, and it's a $5,000 mic. So that speaks volumes for how good that mic is, that it sounded like a lot more expensive than I thought. But then I think the last takeaway that I really want to say is, like, if I'm a young up-and-coming guy, all of this stuff that we're talking about is very relevant, and you hear it on all the message boards and all the stuff. And it's pretty, we're pretty much, frankly, reinforcing some stereotypes, which I think is okay. But the VMS has to come out swinging. Because if I'm starting off and I've got my Focusrite or my Audient, whatever it is, to input, you know, like you've got over here, these inexpensive $300 starter, and somebody like me is giving advice, I would say the VMS is pretty amazing value for money. Because that 47, we noticed, was really close to two flagship mics, like the real Telefunken and the Flea, which is your very popular 47. It came in blindfold test as being pretty darn close. Not exact, but for $1,000, pretty remarkable. So I think there's a lot to take in there. There's some reinforcing a lot of things that I came in. Two big things for me, though, takeaways were the Manly. Can't believe how inexpensive it is. It's expensive. Don't
we're
get me
talking
wrong.
About the reference board.
Yeah, but for how close, how good it was for that price, and the Bock for a 251 was pretty minor. Everything else was very exciting and to hear. And the Russian crazy mic.
Soyuz.
I mean, it's not hi-fi, but it's got a lot of, I hate this word, but I'm going to use it, vibe. It's got a lot of color and texture. Yeah. So I don't know. I mean, that's my main takeaways. Is there anything you think I missed?
So for those folks who are hoping that this will help them you know, push them over the edge on a certain decision, you know, number one, all the microphones in there are
they're all wonderful mics.
Really amazing. And I want people to get started.
Yeah.
You know, I want them to, and I want them to know. Yeah.
The Lawton.
Oh yeah, of course.
Sounded fantastic.
The $499 mic.
$499 for a cheap mic.
Yeah.
I can't believe that didn't come to me first because, yeah, if you want a takeaway, you want to get started with a cheap mic, $500.
Hard to beat.
Hard to beat. Yeah. Yeah. Sorry, carry on.
No, that's quite all right. That's quite all right. So, and Vintage King will support a person who like makes a commitment,
great,
buys a microphone. They still have 30 days to try it out. I want them to have a great mic.
Yeah.
You know, and I want them to, you know, order a microphone until they've got the right one.
Great. That's pretty remarkable. Yeah. Like you said, there's not a bad mic in there. It really comes from perspective. I think it's identifying whether you're a solo artist and you want to come in and find the mic for you, or whether you're a studio owner, but you're at the beginning of your studio owner career, then I think VMS is probably where I would lean. If you're going in there, you want to spend a bit more money, then you've got the old favorites. Probably an 87 is a nice step up because it's got name recognition, but it's not the $5,000 to $10,000 range. There's some logical stuff there. It's like we were saying on camera earlier, the questions always are, number one, what's your budget? And then you find out more about the client, what their needs are.
Right.
But you need to know how much they really want to spend to match it with their needs, you know. Yeah. Awesome. Thank you ever so much.
Thank you, Warren.
I appreciate it. As ever, please subscribe. If you've got this far to the end of our 17 and a half hour long video, that is, please subscribe. Leave a bunch of questions and comments below. I really appreciate all of your time staying through this video. Thanks to Alex. Thanks to Vintage King for letting us come down and try out all these mics. So have a marvelous time recording and mixing, and we'll speak to you again soon.